In this video in my Logisim series, I'll show the addition of a hardware user stack to make subroutine parameter passing and local variables easier. If you saw my previous Logisim video, you'll know I already created a hardware call stack. These two stacks together make subroutines and recursion easier. Here's my first design of the user stack. In order to pop the stack contents into the Y register, I had to make the MUX and the encoder 8 input, since they now exceed 4 inputs. There wasn't much room left to do that, but I did manage to shift things around to make it all fit. And I made room for the user stack subcircuit. As you can see, the user stack uses the same configuration of circuitry as the call stack. I decided to redesign the user stack a little by adding the ability to read and write to the stack without removing the values from the stack. This is done with an access user stack or AUS control line. The Z register contains the offset added to the user stack pointer. The controlled buffers ensure that this alternate stack access method doesn't conflict with the normal stack operations. If you saw one of my previous videos on gated clocks, you'll know I removed all the unnecessary gated clocks by using the main clock instead. Unfortunately, just as with the call stack, I had to use a gated clock in this new stack. I tried every combination and there was no way to get a non-gated clock to work. The problem is that with a non-gated clock, the stack pointer counter has to be falling edge. This works fine for push, but for pop, the stack pointer is changed after the RAM is read, rather than before, so the wrong value is popped. And it's even worse if the stack RAM is triggered by the main clock. Here are the new instructions. You'll notice that there's no SWRITE instruction. This is because, unfortunately, I couldn't get the timing to work when modifying an arbitrary user stack element. In this version of Logisim, you can't specify how the RAM writes are triggered, falling edge, rising edge, etc. With other versions, you can. In this version, the RAM is written to on the rising edge, so it writes the new value to the top of the stack before the offsetted stack address is available. Thus, it writes to the wrong address. It would probably work if I could change the triggering. I had to add 3 new control lines to the CPU. You push, you pop, and AUS. And as usual, the control ROM had to be edited to add the new instructions. And the new lines were added to my control ROM calculator. Here's a program to test the new instructions. I made sure to load the Y register with junk values before each pop and S read to make sure it really is sending the stack values to the register. SRead1 reads the top of the stack, SRead2 reads the second from the top, etc. Let's run it at a slower speed so you can see the values change. This is the test program with the failed SWRITE instructions. To test recursion, I decided to write a factorial calculator. This one is different than the one in my previous videos, since it doesn't do arbitrary precision arithmetic, aka big num arithmetic. So it will only work for numbers that fit into a 32-bit integer value. But it does illustrate recursion, and even has a better keyboard input routine, which converts the multi-character ASCII input to an integer value. Besides, the other factorial calculator was iterative, not recursive. Here's the program. The comments contain the C version of this factorial method. As you can see, the value is computed by recursively calling the multnums function. The variable n is pushed onto the stack to send it to the printval routine. Since the user stack is separate from the call stack, I don't have to pop the value off after a subroutine call. In most cases you would want to, but in this case, I need to send n to multnums, so no need to pop it off and push it back on. I use sRead here because I want to read the passed value, but I don't want to remove it. By the way, sRead and sWrite were meant to provide local variable capability to subroutines. Without swrite, I guess I now have immutable local variables. This is the routine to get the value from the keyboard. It keeps reading the keyboard until it gets a character turn. Then it converts the stored buffer into an integer value. The printval routine rather sloppily converts an integer value into ASCII to print it on the screen. Rather than coding a new routine, which would use a loop, I figured I would just expand an existing routine in order to do larger numbers. And now, my ray tracer. Since Logisim is rather slow, I'll show it running on my graphical simulator first. If you saw my previous Logisim video, you may remember my ray tracer only had reflection with one level of recursion. Now with a user stack, my ray tracer can do full recursion and even refraction. In this scene, every object is reflective, and with multiple levels of recursion, this results in multiple levels of reflection. Here's the scene with the green ball both reflective and refractive. It is now glass. But I did make it less reflective, so it wouldn't look too messy. This simplified ray tracer doesn't fully handle total internal reflection. It doesn't spawn off reflection rays when total internal reflection occurs. In this scene, that only occurs in one pixel, and that's probably due to mathematical inaccuracies inevitable in 32-bit floating point values, so I can live with that omission. I programmed the ray tracer to move the balls in different directions and move one of the lights to the left. The scene is getting darker because the brighter light is moving away. I've put the new ray tracer assembly language code near the end of this video. I haven't fully refactored the code to take full advantage of the user stack. Some repetition could be eliminated by making the routines more general via parameter passing. Most of the refactoring involved using the user stack to temporarily store local variables during each recursion level. For this Logisim demo, I chose to start the render at a more interesting area of the scene, and also render a smaller size, since I knew it would take a long time to calculate. These 8 rows of the scene took 25 hours. And this is what Logisim would have shown if I hadn't stopped it. Using lower resolutions, speed things up. I added a new feature to my simulator. You can zoom in and out by pressing the function keys. This is especially useful for the lowest resolution. Even at the highest resolution, you can zoom and pan. This makes it easier to see the reflections, etc. I thought I'd show this scene again for those who didn't see my previous Logisim video. I took the simple scene I created for my CPU's assembly language ray tracer and improved it using the full ray tracer I wrote in C. I also expanded the breakpoint capability used in my simulators. Now you can output a more meaningful message using the breakpoints instruction. And I added the ability to turn off breakpoints in the simulator in case they get too overwhelming. And you can always turn them back on via the menu. By the way, my Logisim CPU design will just treat these breakpoints as no-ops, so the same programs can run in the Logisim version. And here's the new ray tracer code. All this assembly language programming has given me an interest in teaching myself x86 assembly language. It would be nice to convert this ray tracer to x86 assembly. I wanted to write a conversion program, but x86 assembly is a little too different than mine, making a converter more of a first step rather than a do-it-all automated process. I don't know if I will write an x86 version of this ray tracer, but I did teach myself x86 assembly, which should be the topic of a future video. Here's the new refraction routine. The shadow routine had to be modified to consider light attenuation by a transparent object. By the way, from now on, my new videos will be open to language translations submitted by viewers. This applies to titles, descriptions, and more importantly, subtitles. So if you want, feel free to submit a translation or review an existing one. Please subscribe, like, share, etc. And if you click subscribe, ring the bell to receive notifications of future videos.